Just before we get started with today's video, I do want to thank Brilliant for sponsoring it. To support Today I Found Out and learn more about Brilliant, go to brilliant.org/brainfood, and the first 200 of you to do that will get 20% off your annual premium subscription. And let's get into it. Today we're answering a viewer question because TrunksMe32 asks us, how do outdoor vending machines keep the Coke from freezing in the winter? Vending machines of some form or another have been around since at least the 1st century AD, with the first known of such being supposedly made by Hero of Alexandria, a Greek engineer who invented, among many other remarkable machines, one to automatically dispense holy water. Though it should be noted that many historians think it likely that at least some of Hero's machines were probably invented by others before and simply documented by Hero. Whatever the case on this one, as described in the Pneumatics of Hero of Alexandria, if into certain sacrificial vessels a coin of 5 drachms be thrown, when the coin is thrown through the mouth, it will fall upon the plate, and preponderating, it will turn the beam and raise the lid so that the water will flow. But if the coin falls off, the lid will descend and close the box so that the discharge ceases. Thus, in a nutshell, you deposit a coin of sufficient weight and it drops onto the plate. This causes the plate to tilt down, opening a valve, which in turn allows the holy water to flow. Soon, the plate will tilt enough that the coin falls off, at which point a counterweight pulls up said plate. When it reaches its top position, the connected valve is shut. Of course, this machine had no mechanism for continuing to work properly if the holy water froze. Clearly, Hero was smart not to quit his day job as a teacher. Moving swiftly on to relatively modern times, vending machines of a variety of types began popping up more and more over the centuries, with an explosion in popularity occurring during the 19th century. For example, by the 1890s, the German chocolate maker Stollwerk was operating a network of close to 15,000 vending machines that dispensed their chocolate. Around the early 20th century, selling beverages in vending machines became just as ubiquitous, though not storing bottled drinks at first, instead simply dispensing water and the like from some form of fountain. Notably here, many of these early fountains did not provide cups other than a single common container. Naturally, this metal can be shared by everyone who used a drinking fountain, whether of the vending machine variety or whether it was free for public use, which was eventually deemed less than sanitary. Indeed, so much was this the case that some regions began banning them. In an attempt to find a solution to the problem, Lawrence Lullian envisioned a disposable paper cup that could be dispensed for a penny, about 29 cents today, via a specially designed vending machine. And so it was that the American Water Supply Company of New England was founded in 1908, eventually becoming the more familiar-sounding Dixie Cup Company. Beyond just dispensing disposable cups, one design, the Lullian Cup and Water Vendor, also contained a large jug with water, a large ice container to keep the water cold, and a garbage can to put the cups in after use. Much like Hero's and the other beverage drinking machines up to then, this one had no means of keeping the liquid from freezing either. This finally brings us to slightly more modern times. Ubiquitous today, with Japan having the highest number of vending machines per capita at just under 6 million, or about one vending machine for every 22 people, one of the most popular vending machines is the kind that dispenses life-giving water-based products. For some odd reason, many of these are placed in that eerie region that exists outside of our mother's basements, known as out of doors. This area, which exists in a region that has no solid barriers between you and the never-ending void of space, occasionally gets cold, we're told, despite the silent glowing orb in the sky that's watching, judging, and showering us in ionizing radiation in all its efforts to destroy us. While you might think surely these modern outdoor units, which exist in such a deadly environment, must have some sort of dedicated heating mechanism inside, it turns out this isn't always the case, even in relatively frigid areas. To be clear here, the varieties of designs of vending machine out there are immense, but it turns out that the tiny bit of heat given off by the internal evaporator fan and circuitry is, in many climates, sufficient to keep any drinks inside from freezing. You see, in order to be as energy efficient as possible, bottled beverage machines are extremely well insulated and sealed. In fact, in some modern peak shift vending machines, they primarily cool the internal beverages at night when electricity is cheapest, bringing the liquid as close to freezing as possible without turning their innards solid, and then just let the insulation do the rest during the daytime. Coca-Cola reports their machines using this design, on average, use only about 5% of the daytime energy usage as more typical machines. Beyond insulation, the sugary or diet drinks generally found inside have much lower freezing points than pure water. These two things combine to make it so that active heating is not really needed in many regions. As one vending machine stocker in Kansas, which for reference sees average lows in its coldest month of January at around 20 degrees Fahrenheit or minus 7 degrees Celsius, notes, "In 30 years, I have only seen one freezer. The evaporator fan motor will provide enough heat to keep it from freezing, provided everything else is sealed up good." That said, some regions get colder and require more than just passive heating. The most common mechanism for dedicated heating is simply wiring in an incandescent light bulb socket and screwing a 40 or 60 watt bulb in. This is then automatically switched on when temperatures drop below a certain level. As for the location of the bulb, it is usually placed near the top of the innards to ensure the drinks below, which are dispensed first in many designs, stay as cold as possible and away from the heat source. For those wishing for an alternate solution, some machine designs use heat pump systems capable of reversing and heating the inside. Beyond allowing these units to function well in even some of the coldest of populated regions, these systems are also among the most energy efficient at cooling as well. But to sum up, thanks to being well insulated and the lower freezing points of many of the liquids contained therein, the heat given off by the internal components in vending machines is usually sufficient to keep things from freezing. When not sufficient, a simple incandescent light bulb is relatively cheaply installed, and it solves the problem even in some of the coldest populated regions of our little planet-sized spaceship. Now, we've touched on some pretty simple science today, but you can take that a step further with today's sponsor, Brilliant, who I want to tell you about before we get into all of the bonus facts for today. Now, you've heard me talk about Brilliant before. Brilliant believe that becoming great at maths, science, and computer science doesn't have to be dull. Brilliant teaches you how to be great at these things through problem solving and using a hands-on approach, both online and through their app. Interactive challenges, code writing, storytelling, problem solving, these are all things you can do with Brilliant. It's really built for ambitious and curious people who want to excel at problem solving and understanding the world, and given you're watching this video, I imagine that you might be one of those people. Brilliant have new interactive content, whether you want to master logic or some math fundamentals, Brilliant, they're there for you. Or on the other hand, there's probability, which can be useful for real-world applications or for the use in things like casino games. Effective learning is all about problem solving, and Brilliant help you learn something and then immediately put it into practice. It's a great, super effective way to learn, and it's a great complement to watching educational videos like this one. You'll soon be unraveling complex concepts piece by piece and discovering truths in unexpected places. So go to brilliant.org and finish your day a little smarter. The first 200 of you to do so will get 20% off your annual subscription. And let's get into those bonus facts. Among the astounding number of other devices created by Hero includes essentially the ancient equivalent of a modern door chime, but instead of using a bell or things like that, Hero used a trumpet. The system was apparently installed on temple doors. In a nutshell, on this one, when the door was opened, it caused a vessel to descend into water in a container, thereby creating a bit of water pressure, which in turn forced air through a trumpet, causing it to sing the song of its people. When the door was closed, it draws the vessel back up as well as air back into the trumpet, ready to blow again when the next person opens the door. And I'm definitely sure this never annoyed any meditating priests. And now for another bonus fact. Many modern network-controlled Coca-Cola vending machines are able to be enabled for dispensing their contents for free at the push of a remote button. Coca-Cola occasionally uses this feature in times of emergency as a form of disaster relief, notably using them this way during the 2011 Tohoku earthquake and tsunami. Some designs of these machines even include things like solar power and batteries or generators to continue functioning for a time in case of a power outage. As you might imagine, given their added cost, most of these so-called disaster relief vending machines are only installed in places like hospitals, schools, and a variety of such places where people tend to congregate during extreme disasters. So, downside tsunami, upside free drinks. And now for another bonus fact. Speaking of incandescent light bulbs being decent little heat sources, using about 95% of the power they consume for heat rather than light, one company in Germany attempted to use this fact to get around certain government regulations. You see, given newer, more efficient options became commercially available for lighting, such as CFL and LED lights, governments began instituting regulations, first limiting and ultimately banning the sale of incandescent light bulbs in various regions. For example, in the United States, the phase-out began in 2012, while in the European Union it began in 2009. In order to get around the rules and regulations, a couple of entrepreneurs began marketing old-fashioned light bulbs as useful and convenient alternative heat sources, which they dubbed the heat ball. The brainchild of German engineers Siegfried Rothauser and Rudolf Hannert, the heat ball was sold across Europe, and its marketing touted its convenience since the heat ball would, to quote, fit in any conventional socket that was made for light bulbs. At the cost of just €1.69, that's $1.86 per bulb, the heat ball sold like hotcakes. When the first lot of 4,000 was made available in April of 2010, it sold out in just 3 days. There was also a back order of 40,000 units. As you might imagine, EU officials soon stepped in, seizing a second shipment at the airport in Cologne, France, in November of 2010. At the subsequent administrative hearing in Aachen, Germany, challenging the seizure, Rothauser and Hannert appeared with a mobile heating device that primarily comprised of a ribbon metal plate and a battery connected by 100 wires to a 100-watt light bulb that heated the metal. The administrative judges remained unconvinced of the bulb's efficacy as an alternative heat source, and they banned the further sale of the newfangled heat balls. So I really hope you found that video interesting. If you did, please do hit that thumbs up button below. And most importantly, please visit our fantastic sponsor, Brilliant. They are linked to below. And as always, thank you for watching.